Today, we will be studying one of the most important practical from physical pharmaceutics too. So, we will be going through the aim of the practical, theory associated with the practical, requirements and procedure for the practical, observation table, calculation and formulas, and at the end, the result of the practical. So, the aim of today's practical is to determine the shelf life of aspirin solution in 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution using accelerated stability studies. So basically, we are going to study the hydrolysis, in short degradation, of aspirin, which is having chemical name as acetyl salicylic acid, to form salicylic acid and acetic acid. Now, let us dig into the theory associated with this practical. First of all, let us try to understand what shelf life of dosage form means. Shelf life for a drug may be defined as the time required for a drug to reduce its concentration to 90% of the labeled concentration. The evaluation of shelf life is essential because the stability of drug in the dosage form can be influenced by the normal environmental conditions of storage like temperature, light, air, humidity and packaging conditions. So, as a result, the drug may not exhibit desired biological effect and may show reduced biological action. Hence, it is crucial to study the chemical alteration associated with the API to gain the knowledge of chemical kinetics involved in the process and to predict the reaction rates and further to evaluate the shelf life. So basically, in the determination of shelf life, we need to identify the factors which might affect the stability of drug for the shelf life of the dosage form. The older method involved placing the drug product at room temperature or in refrigerator to mimic the shelf conditions for a prolonged period of 2 to 5 years. But this method is time consuming and uneconomical. Therefore, there was a need of a method which will give the result or at least the prediction of the degradation of the dosage form in minimum span of time. Therefore, to obtain the result in minimum time, the stability studies are carried out at elevated temperature and humidity because these two are the situations which will be faced most of the time by the dosage form. It is generally considered that the drug reaction is a zero order or a first order reaction. Accelerated stability studies is an experimental design to evaluate the stability of a product by accelerating the rate of reaction. So here, instead of carrying out the stability studies using conventional method and for waiting longer period, the time span of experiment is reduced so that one can study the rate of reaction, the byproducts which are formed during the reaction, and the causes of instability of the dosage form. And that is why this experiment is called as accelerated stability studies. So, as we have understood, temperature, humidity and motion are the three main factors of the degradation of the dosage form. So, let us talk about temperature. Arrhenius, it is a name of scientist, so he gave an equation which established a more quantitative relationship between temperature and rate of reaction. So if this reaction rate constant increases, the rate of reaction also increases. So the exponential equation for this is K is equal to A to the base E raised to minus Ea upon RT, where K is specific rate constant, A is Arrhenius factor, Ea is energy of activation in kilojoules per mole, R is ideal gas constant in kilojoules per mole into Kelvin, and T is absolute temperature in Kelvin. So, if we need to calculate energy of activation, we'll have to land on different formula. Energy of activation can be defined as the minimum energy required by the molecule so that molecular collisions give useful product. So, in order to calculate energy of activation, this equation can be used. Log K is equal to log A minus in bracket Ea upon 2.303 RT. So, once we obtain this formula, we will be determining the value of energy of activation using graphical method. So, we will plot log K on y-axis, which is an dependent quantity, and on x-axis we will be plotting 1 upon T, which will be independent quantity. So this graph will yield a slope value. So in order to calculate energy of activation, we will multiply slope of the graph by 2.303 multiplied by R, where R is 8.314 joules per mole into Kelvin. Importance of studying the behavior of drug and dosage form at elevated temperature, humidity, and increased motion. So, various pharmacopoeia suggest various temperature and humidity in order to check the stability of drug. But International Conference on Harmonization, which is oftenly written as ICH, gave a guideline which united the guidelines for the elevated temperature and humidity. So, once a country follows ICH guideline, that particular dosage form will be accepted worldwide. So, as per ICH guidelines, the study type can be classified into three types: long-term studies, intermediate studies, and accelerated stability studies. So, as per ICH, in long-term studies, 25 degrees Celsius plus or minus 2 degrees Celsius and 60% relative humidity plus or minus 5% relative humidity for 12 months, or 30 degrees Celsius plus or minus 2 degrees Celsius and 65% relative humidity plus or minus 5% relative humidity for 12 months. So these conditions can be followed for long-term testing of a dosage form. For intermediate type of stability studies, the storage condition should be 30 degrees Celsius plus or minus 2 degrees Celsius and at 65% relative humidity plus or minus 5% of relative humidity. And it should be carried out at least for 6 months. Whereas ICH suggests that for accelerated stability studies, the storage condition of dosage form should be 40 degrees Celsius plus or minus 2 degrees Celsius difference is allowed, and 75% relative humidity plus or minus 5% relative humidity difference is allowed, and the minimum duration so as to submit the data to the regulatory body should be 6 months. So these criteria should be followed to meet the ICH guidelines, and once a dosage form passes this criteria of long-term, intermediate, and accelerated stability studies, it can be accepted for its stability worldwide. Table 2, where codes and titles which are used in ICH guidelines are indicated. So there are various ICH code. For example, Q1A indicates a guideline regarding stability testing of new drug substances and products, which is second revision. Q1B code stands for stability testing, photo stability testing of new drug substances and product. Q1C code stands for stability testing of new dosage forms. Q1D stands for bracketing and matrixing designs for stability testing of drug substances and products, in short for novel drug delivery systems. Q1E code stands for evaluation of stability data. Q1F code gives information about stability data package for registration applications in climate zones 3 and 4. And ISAGE code Q5C gives guidelines regarding stability testing of biotechnological or biological products such as vaccines and sera. So now we have gone through the principle of the experiment of accelerated stability studies. Now let us move on to the requirements of the chemicals, apparatus and instruments. First of all, we will need salicylic acid, then ferric nitrate solution of concentration 4%, hydrochloric acid solution of 0.1 normality and aspirin. Further, in apparatus, we will need volumetric flask, conical flask, pipette of 5 ml and 10 ml, test tubes, water bath and test tube bag. In instruments, we will need weighing balance, UV double beam spectrophotometer, etc. In procedure, first step is to prepare stock solution of salicylic acid. So ultimately we want 1 mg of salicylic acid per ml of solution. In order to do that, weigh accurately about 100 mg of salicylic acid and transfer into a 100 ml volumetric flask. Add distilled water and shake the solution thoroughly to dissolve salicylic acid. Finally, make up the volume to the mark. Second step involves formation of 4% solution of ferric nitrate solution. In order to do that, one can weigh 4 grams of ferric nitrate and transfer it into a 100 ml measuring cylinder. Add water and dissolve the solid. Finally, make up the volume to the mark. Transfer the solution into an amber color bottle and label. So this solution is light sensitive, that is why it has to be stored in amber color bottle. Third is preparation of hydrochloric acid solution of strength 0.1 normal as per IP. So we have to take really good care while handling acids. So it is prescribed that we should wear good quality of hand gloves while handling or transferring acids. So, in order to prepare 0.1 normal HCl, we can take X normal of HCl. So, here the normality of HCl defined in IP is 85. So, if we want to prepare 1 normal of HCl, we will have to weigh 85 ml of HCl in 1000 ml of water. So, in this case, measure 850 ml of distilled water into a 1000 ml volumetric flask. Add 8.5 ml of concentrated hydrochloric acid slowly to the water and shake. Finally, make up the volume to the mark. In this case, we do not want 1 normal of hydrochloric acid solution. We want just 0.1 normal. That is why from 85, we have shifted to 8.5 ml of hydrochloric acid. And while mixing water and acid, always acid should be added to the water and not the reverse case. Otherwise, it might cause into heating of the vessel and it might burst. Further, we need to prepare standard plot for salicylic acid. Here, the reason to prepare the standard calibration curve for salicylic acid is, from the standard calibration curve, we can get to know the concentration of salicylic acid present in the test sample. In order to do that, firstly, we will have to prepare the dilutions from the stock solution as shown in the table. and the volume in which the dilution should be made is of 20 ml test tube. Add 5 ml of ferric nitrate solution to the test tubes. The solution turns purple in color after addition of ferric nitrate. Now measure the absorbance of the solutions at 547 nanometer using a calorimeter or spectrophotometer and report the observations. Further, plot a graph by taking on x-axis and absorbance on y-axis. This plot is a straight line that passes through the zero dilution. So, in order to plot calibration curve, we need to prepare at least 6 samples. So, in first test tube of 20 ml, we will take stock solution of salicylic acid as 0 ml, which means we will take no amount of salicylic acid but 10 ml of distilled water. In second test tube, we will take 0.2 ml of stock solution of salicylic acid and 9.8 ml of distilled water. In third test tube, we will be taking 0.4 ml of salicylic acid and 9.6 ml of distilled water. In fourth test tube, we will take 0.6 ml of stock solution of salicylic acid and 9.4 ml of distilled water. In fifth test tube, we will take 0.8 ml of stock solution of salicylic acid and 9.2 ml of distilled water. And lastly, in sixth test tube, we will take 1 ml of stock solution of salicylic acid plus 9 ml of distilled water. So the addition of these two columns should land on 10 ml of total volume. So in the first test tube, the concentration of salicylic acid, if we take it in mg per ml, there will be 0 mg of salicylic acid concentration because we have added nothing from the stock solution. Here it will be 0.02 mg of salicylic acid. Here it will be 0.04. Here it will be 0.06. Here it will be 0.08. And here it will be 0.1 because we have gone for one fold dilution. And that is why this point shift towards one place right. And that is why these are 0.02, 0.04, 0.06, 0.08 and 0.1. So once we land on this mixtures of the concentration of salicylic acid and water, we need to subject it for proper analysis using suitable instrument. So using UV absorbance method, these are the various absorbances which are observed for the respective concentration of salicylic acid. So further, we will plot a graph by taking concentration of salicylic acid in mg on x-axis because it is an independent quantity and absorbance on y-axis. So it will yield this kind of line, which is called as calibration curve, and as we have discussed, it will pass through zero. So it will have 6 points and it will also display a line equation y is equal to mx plus c. In this case, the equation is y is equal to 7.118x plus 0.012, where the R square value is 0.991. So here we can say that the slope value is 7.118 and the intercept is plus 0.012. Now that was the procedure for drawing or preparing the calibration curve of salicylic acid. Now let us move on to procedure of accelerated stability studies. Accelerated stability studies, in this case, we have to study aspirin decomposition, that is hydrolysis, at temperature of 50 degrees Celsius. So first step, we need to switch on the water bath and adjust the temperature at 50 degree. Second, we have to transfer 100 ml of 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution into a conical flask and keep it in water bath, that is at 50 degrees Celsius. so that the temperature of the solution inside the conical flask will have temperature of 50 degrees Celsius. Third step, weigh accurately 100 mg of aspirin, that is acetyl salicylic acid. Then transfer the aspirin into a 250 ml conical flask. Later, add 1 or 2 ml of alcohol to dissolve aspirin, because aspirin is poorly soluble in water. That is why we need co-solvent, and hence we have added 1 or 2 ml of alcohol to dissolve aspirin into alcohol. Later, add slowly 90 ml of 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution that was kept on water bath so as to attain the temperature of 50 degrees Celsius, and shake thoroughly. Dissolved aspirin should not get precipitated. So after addition of 90 ml of 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid, there are chances that aspirin will precipitate, because it is an acidic drug, and acidic drug in acidic environment may have tendency to precipitate. But in this case, the alcohol will prevent the possible precipitation of aspirin in 0.1 normal HCl. Finally, add 10 ml of 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid. Further, immediately after placing in the water bath, withdraw a 10 ml sample from the mixture. So after mixing everything, that is aspirin, ethanol and 0.1 normal HCl, shake it vigorously so that all aspirin goes into solution, and mark this time 0 and withdraw the sample of 10 ml from the mixture, which will be marked as 0 sample time with pipette, and transfer into 20 ml test tube. This represents 0 time sample. Similarly, withdraw samples after 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 and 60 minute time period. Once all the samples are collected, add 5 ml of ferric nitrate solution to each test tube. The color of solution turns purple. Once the color is changed, measure the absorbance of the sample at 547 nanometer using suitable instrument and record the observations. Further, plot a graph by taking time on x-axis and log percent aspirin undecomposed, which will be used as log E on y-axis. So this was the procedure for determining the decomposition of aspirin at 50 degrees Celsius. We have to repeat the same procedure in order to study the decomposition of aspirin at 60 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius. Now, after understanding the principle of the experiment, let us move on to the practical of accelerated stability studies. In this experiment, we will be learning the hydrolytic decomposition of acetyl salicylic acid, that is aspirin, at 50 degrees Celsius. So let us proceed with the experiment. Here, I have taken 100 ml of 0.1 normal HCl. Now, we need to transfer this 100 ml of 0.1 normal HCl into the conical flask. We need to take really good care while handling acids. So once we are done pouring 0.1 normal HCl, we will have to keep it for heating at 50 degrees Celsius. So I am transferring this conical flask in the heating mantle, and now I will try to adjust the temperature at 50 degrees Celsius. As we can see here, the temperature of solution has started rising and it has reached till the level of 35 degrees Celsius.
So we will wait for some more time to reach the temperature of 0.1 normal HCl to 50 degrees Celsius.
After some time, we can see the temperature of 0.1 normal HCl has reached till the level of 50 degrees Celsius. And now, we will switch off the heating mantle. So the next step of experiment is to weigh aspirin. So I have weighed 0.1 gram, that is 100 mg of aspirin. And now we will make an attempt to dissolve aspirin into ethanol. Since it's an organic compound, it is hydrophobic in nature, and thus we will have to use ethanol to dissolve 100 mg of aspirin. Here I have added aspirin into ethanol, and now I will try to solubilize it by giving it a gentle swirl. So we can see few particles of aspirin are still not dissolved. So I'll shake it vigorously so that maximum amount of aspirin goes in ethanol. So now we can see a comparatively clear solution. So after vigorously shaking the conical flask, we can see the maximum amount of aspirin is dissolved in ethanol, and now we will proceed for the further experiment. In next step, we will take out the previously heated 0.1 normal HCl, which was heated till 50 degrees Celsius, and now we will add approximately 90 ml of 0.1 normal HCl into the aspirin solution. We are going to add it little by little, and then let us give a gentle swirl to it. Now we will shake it vigorously so that the aspirin does not precipitate in the conical flask. Now lastly, we will add the leftover amount of 0.1 normal HCl into aspirin solution. And we will shake it vigorously. Now we can see comparatively clear solution is obtained, which states that the aspirin has dissolved into the acidic environment and is not precipitating. On further shaking, we will try to make this solution clear. After vigorous shaking, we can see that we have obtained the clear solution of aspirin plus 0.1 normal HCl with the aid of ethanol.
Here I have taken the test tubes and I have marked them as 0 minute, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 40 minutes and so on, so as to collect the sample from our reaction vessel into the test tube. So immediately after the reaction, I will take out 10 ml from this system and I will pour it in test tube using a pipette and mark it as 0 minute sample. Now after 10 minutes, again we need to pipette out 10 ml of mixture from the conical flask into the test tube, and we will put it in the test tube which is labeled for 20 minute sample. So this is a previously prepared ferric nitrate solution, and now we will be putting 5 ml of ferric nitrate solution into the samples withdrawn at 10 minute interval. Here I have weighed 5 ml of ferric nitrate solution, and now I'm going to pour this solution into 0 minute time interval sample. So as you can see, as the ferric nitrate solution diffuses into the sample tends to change its color. After adding the ferric nitrate solution to the samples, we can see the sample has changed its color and has turned to bluish yellow. Now we will be measuring the absorbance of samples using suitable instrument at 547 nanometer wavelength.
Let us move on to noting down the observation and calculations. So here we have data generated for aspirin decomposition when stored at temperature of 50 degrees Celsius, 60 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius. So we will prepare a table in this format where there will be time after every 10 minute interval till 60 minutes. Second column, we will have decomposed aspirin. Here we are studying the decomposition of aspirin, and the decomposed product will be salicylic acid. So using the equation from standard calibration curve of salicylic acid, we can determine the amount of decomposed aspirin in the solution. So once we get the total decomposed amount of aspirin, and when we subtract this amount from the total amount of aspirin present in system, we get aspirin remain undecomposed, which can be said as aspirin that is intact in the formulation. So if we carry out the subtraction, we will get these values. If we multiply them by 100, we will have percentage undecomposed aspirin. Further, we need to take log of this column, and this column will yield these values. So once we can proceed for further graphs. So here we need to construct a first order plot by taking time t on x-axis in minutes and log e on y-axis. A straight line is obtained with a negative slope of line. So we will take time t on x-axis and log e on y-axis. Time t on x-axis and log e on y-axis. This will be considered as log e. So once we draw a graph, we will have a straight line with the negative slope of line. So once we have slope, which is equal to slope k, then we can multiply slope by 2.303 so as to have value of slope k. So let us go to the graphs. Here we have taken time in minutes on x-axis and log of percent undecomposed drug on y-axis. So here you can see the decomposition profile at three different temperatures for aspirin. This blue line indicates the decomposition at 50 degrees Celsius. Red line indicates decomposition at 60 degrees Celsius. And green line yields decomposition at 70 degrees Celsius. So in this way, a graph should be drawn. Now, we have to obtain the slope from this graph. So, once we are done drawing the graph, we have to obtain the slope values. So, I have obtained the slope values. So, for 50 degrees Celsius, this is a slope value. For 60 degrees, this one is the slope value. And 70 degrees, this one is the slope value. So, as it is mentioned, a negative slope value will be yielded, and we can see all three slope values are negative. So, in order to have slope k, we have to multiply those slope values by 2.303, and in the end, we will have value for slope k at 50 degrees Celsius, 60 degrees Celsius, and 70 degrees Celsius. And further, we have to report this data in a table. Slope values from the graph. We have to take the log of the slope and present it as log k. So, I have put temperature in the first column. I have taken log of the slope values in the second last column, and here I have converted the temperature from degree Celsius to Kelvin. I have converted 50 degrees Celsius to Kelvin, that is 323.15 Kelvin. For 60, it's 333.15, and for 70, it's 343.15 Kelvin. Further, we need to take 1 upon T into 10 raised to 3, that is 1000 multiplication. So that using these criteria, we can draw a graph for an Arrhenius equation. So by taking 1 upon T into 10 raised to 3 on x-axis, this element, and log k plus 3, where 3 is added in this value, and we land on log k plus 3 on y-axis, construct the Arrhenius plot. So we need this column and this column for constructing the Arrhenius plot, and later calculate the slope of Arrhenius plot. So here I have drawn the Arrhenius plot by taking 1 upon t into 10 raised to 3 on x-axis. So, it is nothing but 1 upon t into 1000 on x-axis, and log k value on y-axis, and I have put these values on the graph, and we will have a curve or a line like this, which is indicated by blue color. And in order to have slope of this line, I have presented an equation over here, which is a line equation, y is equal to mx plus c. So y is equal to m, which is nothing but 0.768x plus c, means intercept. So intercept in this case is plus 2.351. So by having the Arrhenius plot, we are landing on this equation, and in the end we have got the value for slope as 0.768. Calculations. We can now calculate the energy of activation, where energy of activation is equal to slope into 2.303 into R. So in this case we have obtain slope from the Arrhenius equation, and it is this value 0.768. So we need to multiply 0.768 into 2.303 into R, where R is a constant having value 8.31. So if this energy of activation value lies in the range of 10 to 30 kilocalorie per mole, the accelerated stability studies are considered valid. So the result of this equation we will consider in the next slide. Further, extrapolate the Arrhenius law to room temperature. The y-intercept gives log k value. So now we need to extrapolate Arrhenius plot to room temperature. First, we will have to consider the room temperature at 25 degrees Celsius and we will have to convert it to Kelvin. And once we convert it into Kelvin, we can carry out a division 1 upon room temperature at 25 degrees Celsius, which is now converted into Kelvin, multiplied by 1000. So the value is obtained nearby 3.1. So this is our value for room temperature. Now we need to draw a line straight from the x-axis, which will be intersecting the Arrhenius plot somewhere over here, and we need to extrapolate the line to y-axis, where we will have the value of log k. So log k at room temperature will be 4.76. So now we have log k value. In order to have the value of k, we need to take anti-log of log k. So the anti-log of obtained value was found to be 0.6776. So further, in order to calculate shelf life, for first order reaction, shelf life equation may be expressed as shelf life is equal to 0.105 upon k25. So now in order to calculate shelf life, we will have to divide 0.105 by 0.6776. So after a series of calculations, let us land on results. So there are two results which are obtained from this experiment. The shelf life of aspirin in 0.1 normal hydrochloric acid solution, which was determined using Arrhenius equation, was found to be 3.71 hours. Actually, the shelf life is given in months, but considering the shelf life of aspirin, it is really less. That is why I have represented it in hours. And secondly, the energy of activation is 14.70 kilocalories per mole. So that is why we can say that the experiment of accelerated stability studies was valid, because this range of energy of activation lies between the given range of energy of activation where it is considered as valid. Here we are concluding our experiment. Now let us go through some of the synopsis questions which might be asked or which can be helpful to clarify our doubts. First question. Entry information that should accompany the shelf life on the label. Question 2. Why drugs decompose on storage? Question 3. What is meant by accelerated stability studies? Question 4. Describe the influence of temperature on degradation. Question 5. Write Arrhenius equation and explain its applications. And question 6. Describe the degradation reaction of aspirin. Give the stability indicating assay method for its stability studies. Now let us go through the questions of synopsis one by one. First question is, define shelf life. Mention the supplementary information that should accompany the shelf life on the label. So one can define the shelf life as the period of time from the date of manufacturing that a drug product is expected to retain within its approved product specification while stored under defined conditions. Shelf life is typically expressed in units of 24 months, 36 months to a maximum of 60 months. So, any pharmaceutical product cannot have shelf life more than 5 years. Along with shelf life, dose, handling instructions and storage condition should also be mentioned on the label. So, here I have presented a label of suspension called as Augmentin. It is a very widely used suspension. It is consists of drugs such as antibiotic of amoxicillin and a protective agent which is clavulanate potassium. So this label of Augmentin include brand name, generic name of the drug, the dosage form name, total volume, manufacturer, the instructions to administer the dosage form and to use the dosage form, and lastly the storage conditions of the dosage form. Next question. Why drugs decompose on storage? So the various factors those are responsible for decomposition of drug on storage include pH, moisture, light, dosage form, concentration, drug incompatibility and oxygen. So considering pH, there are multiple drugs which are sensitive to change in pH. So if the pH of the system is altered, the solubility of drug is altered and they tend to precipitate in the formulation, because of which the purpose for which the formulation was prepared is not attained. Second is moisture. Moisture gives ready-made environment for the growth of microorganisms. That is why it leads to microbial instability. Light. It could be the sunlight or the artificial light. Because of light, the atoms in the molecule gain energy and the product tend to decompose because of excess free energy in the formulation. Dosage form, the liquid dosage forms are more susceptible for instability or more susceptible for degradation than that of solid dosage form. The concentration. So it is considered that the formulations having more concentrated drug will have more stability. Further, the concentration of excipients also defines the stability of formulation. If we consider the example of sugar, the sugar syrup, if it exceeds the value of 67%, then it will act as preservative for the formulation. But if the concentration is below 67%, then it will act as a media for the growth of microorganisms. Further, drug incompatibility. If two or more incompatible drugs are present in dosage form, then they tend to precipitate or they tend to degrade one or more of the drug, and the purpose of formulation is not attained. Lastly, oxygen. Oxygen simply carries out the oxidation process of the drug, which is nothing but loss of electrons, and because of that the chemical structure of drug is disturbed, and that is why the formulation is unstable. So these are the factors which decompose the formulation on storage. Moving on to next question. What is meant by accelerated stability studies? So these are the studies designed to increase the rate of chemical degradation and physical change of a drug by using exaggerated storage conditions as part of the formal stability testing program. So basically, in accelerated stability studies, the dosage form is subjected to exaggerated conditions of temperature, relative humidity and movement of the formulation. Main aim of accelerated stability study is to predict the stability profile of drug product before launching into market. This is used in selecting the best formulation from a series of possible choices. So during research and development of a formulation, there are multiple combinations of formulation prepared, and they are subjected to accelerated stability studies. So the formulation which is having least degradation profile will be selected for further studies, and ultimately that will be launched in market. Further, accelerated stability studies also provide a rapid means of quality control, which ensures that no unexpected change has occurred in the store product. So it also gives an idea about the byproduct those are formed during the degradation process of the dosage form. Good formulation will invariably break down more slowly than poor ones. When the perceived optimal formulation is decided, attempts can be made to predict its likely stability at proposed storage condition. So once the formulation is identified as good formulation, then the later stage is to identify its shelf life using the profile of the formulation obtained from accelerated stability studies. The amount of decomposition that is acceptable in fixing an expiry date depends on the particular drug. So it varies from drug to drug. This will be small if therapeutic index is low or if the decomposition products are toxic. So in this way, accelerated stability studies help us to identify the byproducts, to identify the rate of decomposition, to identify the rate of reaction of decomposition, and to identify the best possible combination of the excipients and drug to make a successful and stable formulation. Next question. Describe the influence of temperature on degradation. High temperature accelerates oxidation, reduction, and hydrolysis reaction, which lead to drug degradation. So temperature is going to increase the rate of reaction. When a drug is stored in temperatures that are too high or too low, the drug's chemical stability will likely to be impacted. That is why most of the drugs are stored at room temperature. So that means that the drug may degrade and form impurities if the temperature is vigorously altered. While these impurities may not be visibly noticeable, but this degradation can cause real problems when the drug is administered. So at extreme conditions of temperature, the impurities or the byproducts may be formed, which are not noticeable visually, but they can be toxic sometimes and might affect the health of the patient. So this is how the temperature is responsible for degradation of the dosage form. Question number 5. Write Arrhenius equation and explain its application. So as we all know, Arrhenius equation is associated with prediction of decomposition along with increase in temperature. So the Arrhenius equation can be used to determine the effect of change of temperature on the rate constant and consequently on the rate of reaction. So if the rate constant doubles, for example, so does the rate of reaction. So according to Arrhenius equation, if the rate constant value is doubled, the rate of reaction is also doubled. So the equation for Arrhenius equation is equal to K is equal to A to the base E raised to negative division of EA upon RT, where EA is activation energy, R is gas constant, T is temperature in Kelvin, E is base of natural logarithm, A is pre-exponential factor, and K is rate constant. So this is Arrhenius equation, and this is the application of Arrhenius equation in the pharmaceutical field. Next question is, describe the degradation reaction of aspirin. Give the stability indicating assay methods for its stability studies. So this is the degradation reaction of the aspirin. We have seen it in the previous part. Aspirin is chemically called as acetyl salicylic acid. So it is decomposed because of presence of water. That is why it is called as hydrolysis. So once the water molecule attacks the acetyl salicylic acid, it converts the molecule into salicylic acid plus acetic acid. The stability indicating assay method for aspirin includes use of methods like HPLC, that is high performance liquid chromatography, DSC, that is differential scanning calorimetry, and infrared spectroscopy. So these three methods can be used to identify the amount of aspirin that is decomposed during the storage or during the chemical reaction by water. So here we are concluding our session of synopsis. Thank you everyone for watching the video.